Adam, look who's here. It's Conan O'Brien. Conan. Okay, we've got a, I have a lot of questions for you.
All right.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, the first one is from 14-year-old Jacob Marsing. He asks, I thought like there should be music.
Yes, let's pretend there is.
You are about to take over a staple in the American TV experience. Each
a 14-year-old wrote this?
That's good.
Did he get help from his parents?
He did. A staple in the American TV experience.
Yeah.
Each host has put his own spin on The Tonight Show. When people look back at The Tonight Show with Conan O'Brien 50 years from now, what do you want them to say?
I want them to say he ruined it so no one else could use it.
Thank you, Jacob. 14-year-old.
Sorry, Jay. I want to be, not only the fifth, I don't want to only be the fifth Tonight Show host. I want to be the last. I'm going to break it. No one's going to want it once I'm done with it. It's going to have a certain odor that people find off-putting.
And so, Jacob, when you're 64, you remember this.
Yes.
Next up is Dave Hansen. We know about Dave.
Yeah.
How do you expect the earlier time slot to affect the content of your show?
Well, I'll tell you. I think we live in a day and age where the time slot means less than it used to mean.
Mm-hmm.
You think about what's happened to television. Think about what's happened with DVRs and Twitter and YouTube and Hulu.
Mm-hmm.
People are starting to, TV is, I mean, I think we're about 6 weeks away from TV being a cookie that you just eat and then digest at your leisure and experience the shows internally. So I don't want to get my head too wrapped around that. I want to just get in there and do a funny show, which is, I never thought about 12:30 time slot. I just did a show.
Right.
And some things were over the line and some things were fine. What I realized when we were winding down our late night show, we showed a lot of stuff from the previous 16 years. We showed the best things. And I looked at them. I didn't see one thing that we had done that wouldn't have done very well in a Tonight Show and been funny.
Okay.
So I think I need to just stick with what I've been doing, keep doing that, and if I go over the line and it's not time slot appropriate, I will apologize and then do it again the next day.
And you'll get the memo.
Exactly, yeah, exactly.
Okay, this is from David Judah.
Mm-hmm.
What, if any, type of transition is taking place between you and Jay? Are you currently working with him for insights, suggestions, etc., or are you taking hold and running with your own thoughts and ideas?
These are excellent questions.
That is good.
These are very well written. Let's see. These could all be op-ed pieces in the New York Times. I am, basically, I'm going on my own compass with this Tonight Show. I get along very well with Jay. We talk and, we chat fairly frequently, and I just saw him about 2.5 weeks ago in Florida. And so it's a very friendly handoff and exchange, which is nice. As for what I'm going to do with the show, I'm not really studying his, template and then going to conform to it. I'm going to go my own way, for better and for worse.
Gotcha. Susan Upson, I'd like to know who Conan feels was his favorite guest and who his least favorite guest was.
Well, it's hard to say favorite because there have been so many. I can give you a couple of names that stick out. It's just they're always consistently great. I always loved interviewing Norm Macdonald because it would go off the rails.
Mm-hmm.
He makes me laugh harder than just about anybody. I love people like Tina Fey.
Yeah.
I love people. Tom Hanks is just this consummate professional. He's always funny. He's a huge star, but he is so likable. He's one of the few movie stars who could host a show like this. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
He could do it. He could, and if he just snapped his fingers, he could probably
do
the Tonight Show right now. I shouldn't have said that. Hope he doesn't get any ideas. So those are just some of the people who've been great over time. Also, some of the old school British actors are amazing. Richard Harris.
Oh yeah.
We had him on the show before he passed away. And just this great, had great crazy stories, and at one point he flipped over backwards in the chair, and he just feels like this person has so much life experience they're sharing with you. So those people are great. Worst, hard to say. Very early in the run of my show, I had an interview, I think, with Eartha Kitt, where she was sort of being difficult, and I wasn't experienced enough to handle it. And
I had the same experience.
Oh, did you?
Seriously.
Really?
In the studio.
Wow. I just put everything I said, I'd say, like, so, is it, you know, you once worked with James Dean. Did I? Why would you ask me that?
I know.
What's the point of asking you that?
Yeah.
And then today I think I'd be able to turn that into something amusing. But you need your you need to have a certain amount of experience to be able to do that. And this is very early in the late night run, and
She did a tour of Cinderella, and she came here, and I've only been here I think a year myself, and so I'm terrified of her. But I'd read somewhere on the internet that she was a tough nut, you know, who did yoga and Pilates and demanded a window that opens, but she had one weakness, which was Snickers bars. And so the interview was going horrible. Same kind of thing.
Right, right.
Suddenly I just said, I understand you have a weakness. And she gives me that indignant look, you know, like, I have no weakness.
Right.
And I went, then there's this weird, awkward silence, and she burst out laughing.
Oh, good.
She says, that's cute, I like you. And she took the Snickers, and I was like, oh, my God. But, yeah, she was a trip.
I should have had a Snickers bar. I wish you had told me that. I could have saved myself.
But she was a trip. Okay, how long have you been playing guitar? What kind of music do you play? Asks Owen Dennehy.
Okay, I was a bad drummer in college, and then when I graduated from college, and I didn't have a lot of money, and I moved out to Los Angeles. I had a $380 a month apartment, and I was thinking, I'll have my drums shipped out here. And then I thought, what do you mean my drums shipped out here? You can't set up drums in an apartment building. I'll get kicked out.
Right.
So then I started to think, I want to have an instrument, but I want something that I can play, you know, in a cheap apartment without having to rent studio space.
Right.
And I decided on the guitar. I went to Freedom Guitar in Los Angeles, which is a pretty low end, you know, they sold pretty cheap guitars, and I bought a used Yamaha guitar on the wall for $90, and I bought the Mel Bay chord book. So I was 22, and I started to just figure it out, and over a long period of time, I was single, I was living out in L.A. at the time, I had a lot of downtime, and so I learned the guitar pretty quickly, and I love to play rockabilly music, early Sun Session, Elvis, Carl Perkins. I love to do the singing and the playing. I've done some of it on the show. During the strike shows last year, when I grew the beard, I kept putting on a cowboy hat and singing different rockabilly standards, and it's fun.
Cool. All right, I've got one last question.
Sure.
Let me make sure it's a good one. Not going to ask that. Would that be inappropriate?
Racist.
Okay, Rob Scroggins. Rob Scroggins.
Yeah.
This is a quote. Really, what's with the hair?
That's cool. I don't read anything into that.
I don't either.
That sounds like admiration to me.
I think it does as well.
The hair has a life of its own.
Mm-hmm.
The hair does what it does. I'm at the mercy of the hair. I don't do this to my hair. My hair does this to me. That's the way to look at it. Here's your answer.
Conan O'Brien, thank you so much. We're going to send it back to Adam. You ready? Adam!
Adam!
Take it from us.
Go,
please.
Adam, go.